bombs away, down and down onto another vital industrial target, deep inside Hitler's ruthless fortress of Europe. Pick them up in Britain and dump them down inside Germany. That's the special daylight delivery service that the U.S. 8th Air Force has been running now for more than 14 months. But a lot of work has to be done long before an Air Force can invade Germany, boldly by day. In Britain, the 8th Air Service Command has had to set up a vast and complex system of supply and maintenance and transport and repair. Trucks carry 1.5 million ton miles of bombs per month. An air transport system hauls 1 million pounds of cargo and ferries 1,200 planes each month. And huge British depots have been taken over to do the mountainous job of keeping the 8th Air Force always ready for combat. Since last May, the average time of repair has been cut from 36 days to 10. But still, every plane that comes to Britain to fight in the Battle of Germany must be modified to meet the changing challenge of enemy tactics. Every bomber must get an average of 400 man hours of modification. Every fighter plane must get 200. Tanks give fighter planes the longer range they need to do their job. And Tokyo tanks and the wings of bombers stretch the reach of forts and libs. And the new combat crews, too, they have to go through their own kind of modification before they are ready to fight in the Battle of Germany. Bombardiers and navigators, all of them must get a postgraduate course the combat crew replacement centers. And gunners and radio operators and pilots, they too must learn from veterans the special tricks of combat in the big league. These things must happen before crews can be briefed for an air invasion of another German target.
For a special effort today. I know that if today's results measure up to your past records, that this target will be demolished. I do want this target hit, and I want it hit hard. Gunners will report to the briefing room for a gunnery briefing. Bombardiers report to Captain Culpepper for target folders and materials. Navigators report to Captain Smith in the navigator's room. That'll be all, gentlemen.
At the briefings, the attack order is transmitted to the combat crews of forts and libs and marauders, and to the pilots of Thunderbolts and Lightning, in one complex but synchronized plan of battle. The thrusting lines of attack push always deeper into Germany as the range of fighter protection grows longer and longer. On the eastern knob of Britain, airfields are scattered thick as baseball diamonds in America. And on each U.S. airfield now, forts are lined up, nose to tail for the takeoff. Surge into the air and form quickly. No waste of precious gas. And on other airfields, the Liberators taxi out for the takeoff. Some of the same rugged libs of the 8th that went down to Africa and helped the 9th hammer Ploeschi. Those liberators are back in the Battle of Germany now, fighting from their British bases. Over Britain, the liberators and fortresses of the 8th Air Force form and climb to the altitude they will need before they go over the top into Germany, each task force to its own target. And always the emphasis is on timing to the split second. In no other form of warfare is timing quite so vital as in this lofty combat where death and destruction ride often at 500 miles per hour. On other airfields, while the fortresses and liberators are climbing to altitude over Britain, the twin-engined Marauders get ready for their part in the Battle of Germany. To win this battle, our first job is to beat the Luftwaffe. And the Marauders have done their share of that job. Their bombs have smashed Nazi airfields, first on shallow penetrations of only 30 miles. But now the Marauders hit Luftwaffe bases 100 miles inside Nazi Europe. The frontline trenches of Hitler's air defense have been driven back and back. In the early raids, the Spitfires of the RAF and now the Lightnings of the 8th AAF have had good hunting against the Jerrys, the Jerry planes that are flushed by the Marauders each time they go out. The Spitfires destroyed 100 Huns in a single month on their ramrods with our Marauders. On November 1st, the Marauders hit 88 German targets. Most of the targets were airfields. 4,300 tons of bombs were dropped on their assigned targets. And from all these missions, only 12 Marauders are missing.
R974-122 now at 4635. Thank you. Bomber 160 for tear. Now at 4367.
Besides Nazi airfields, the Marauders have hit other special and vital targets. Here, the Marauders are hammering ammunition dumps that the Huns thought they had hidden safely in the woods below. pressed the Hun hard and they have hurt him. Their combat crews have learned in battle what they will need to know when the ground invasion comes. And in the air, the Marauders have worked well and often, with the fortresses and liberators as a valued diversion. The same way a smart fighter uses a left jab to open up the other guy for the knockout punch. In and out, the Marauders go to soften up the Hun for our heavies. One thing about the Battle of Germany. There are no more air raids on Germany. They are all air battles now. Bomber missions no longer destroy Germany merely on the scale of sabotage. Hitler's fortress is today besieged by bombers. Air battles cover lines of attack longer than the Russian front. They cover an area as vast and as complex as any naval operation that involves a whole fleet of battleships and protecting destroyers and aircraft carriers. And remember this about the record of the Eighth Air Force in the Battle of Germany. Not once has any air division or combat wing or even a single group been beaten back from any target by German flak or fighters. Sometimes a group that dispatched perhaps 20 planes would have only two left at the IP. But those two would always fight on through the bombing run and do the job that the group was assigned to do. The air battle for the bombers may begin early as they cross the enemy coast. It may last for 3 hours or more of hammering hell. The rendezvous between fighters and bombers is planned in time to shrink the stretch over which the bombers must fight alone. Welcome to every bomber crew is the sight of the streaking flights of thunderbolts and lightning. Giving the Hun all the odds of fighting over German territory, still the thunderbolts of the 8th have destroyed the Jerrys at the rate of better than 4-1. And given bigger belly tanks for the Thunderbolts, plus the longer range of the Lightnings and the P-51s, the bombers of the 8th will soon have fighter protection over every vital industrial target anywhere inside Germany. Wherever our bombers have fighter cover, there is no weapon yet devised by the Luftwaffe that can keep the forts and libs from doing their job. bombsight in the fishbowl nose of a fortress, on him alone is now focused all the work of the hundreds of men and women who built our bombers and our fighter planes. All the thought and planning and effort, the hundreds of men who work in administration and training and supply of an Air Force. All the work of all these people, plus all the effort and daring of the combat crews, hangs now on the fingers of the bombardier. The strain piles up on him in the brief seconds of the bombing run. Eyes and mind and imagination, too, must concentrate now on your complex gadgets, bombardier. Forget the fighters that queue up to knock you down. And to hell with the flag. Every nerve and muscle must focus now on your target, bombardier, until your bombs are away. Your bombs are gone. You're through working for Uncle Sam for the day. You're working for yourself now, so man those guns, bombardier, and help fight your way home. The bombers of the 8th have pushed on from the early shallow targets in France and on the fringe of Germany, targets vital to Hitler's U-boat warfare. Our bombers since then have smashed synthetic rubber factories, ball bearing factories, all the plants that cripple mechanized warfare. Target of the 8th Air Force has always been any factory that makes our assembles on the ground, Buckwolfs and Messerschmitts that challenge the forts and libs, and our own fighters in the air. When our bombers hit the fighter factory at Regensburg, the 8th Air Force slugged Hitler where it hurts. Then we shuttled on to Africa. Another 8th Air Force bombers have operated from African bases to hit the Hun in the belly. Twice our bombers have crossed the Danube to do their job. With the RAF, we have bombed Germany around the clock. Alone, the 8th has hit the Hun around the map. The smoking engine is a signal for all the Jerrys to queue up on a crippled bomber, like buzzards collecting over a tired horse in the desert. It's tough to fight through to the target. It's still tougher to hold her straight and level on the bombing run. Jerry's watch your bomb bays open, and that's their signal for their most desperate attacks. But toughest of all is the fight to slug your way back through all the flak and fighters that the Hun sends up to ambush you on the run home. parachute going down. One of ours. Combat crews of forts and libs are glad to see. Our own fighters and the Spitfires of the RAF and finally the coast of England on their way home. But the Battle of Germany is not ended even then, because gas is always low on the home stretch. Desperately wounded airmen often fight to keep triple bombers in the air. The demand for cool courage and leather nerve does not slacken with the sight of England. Planes must still be landed, and sometimes that's not easy. This homing Thunderbolt tripped up on a shot-up tire, but at last, he's landed. Than just the 8th Air Force has been tested in the lofty Battle of Germany. Our whole way of life, our industrial strength, our planning, our character as a nation, all that has been tested here in what airmen call the big league. The young men in the combat crews, they have passed this testing time. Many airmen of the 8th wear the Purple Heart. And many Purple Hearts wear the oak leaf cluster, because it takes more than a single wound to ground these boys. The wounded only wonder, how long will it be before they can fly and fight again? The story of a mission comes tumbling out at the interrogation when nerves relax and stomachs stretch happily to hold hot coffee and Spam. And actually, the story of a mission goes on beyond the interrogation. British air sea rescue launches and planes scour the channel of the North Sea to fish combat crews out of the drink. Combat crews that had to ditch their bombers before they could make it home. And on every field, as weary combat crews shuffle off to early beds, harassed engineering officers have a hasty job to do. Because up at Bomber Command, they may be cooking up another mission for tomorrow. And so, during the night, miracles must be performed on battle-damaged planes to get them ready for another job in the morning. 60% of all planes battle-damaged after a rugged run is not rare for bombers of the 8th. Some of the bombers that do get home will never fly or fight again. But some of the bombers that crash land away from their bases do fly again. For instance, there was the story of Stella. She came home on one engine. She crashed and skidded to a stop. And that's where Air Service Command got to work. A mobile repair unit hit the road and took the men and the tools to patch up Stella. And there was plenty of work to do on Stella before she would fly again. On Stella, bulldozers chewed out a hasty runway for Stella's wheel, for her new wheel. This is the end of the story of Stella. But not really the end, but only a new beginning. Because Stella went home to have another crack at the Huns. The end of the story of a mission does not come until photo reconnaissance sends out the lonely prowling planes that carry no guns but only cameras to bring back the pictures that will tell Bomber Command, your job was well done. Or sometimes, sorry, but you didn't quite finish that target. You've got to go back again. And sometimes we're lucky enough to find an eyewitness to give the story of an 8th Air Force mission new headlines.
Corporal McLaughlin, RAMC, just back from Germany, saw U.S. bombers wipe out a Focke-Wulf factory.
Yes, at 7 minutes to one, the air raid alarm sounded. And within 4 minutes from the time that it sounded, the planes were over us. Well, there's a main camp some few hundred yards from where we are, and the boys in there took their shirts off and started waving to the planes.
Well, did any of the boys up top respond to that?
Yes, they dropped their bombs. It was reckoned that they worked 24 hours a day in that plant, off shifts. They did a shift there with 2,000 people. So If there were 2,000 people in the place at the time, there must have been at least 1,500 of them under the wreckage. Every shot landed inside the drone, and I think myself, I agree with the Germans, that it was one of the best raids that they'd ever seen.
We don't know what kind of a communique Goebbels put out on the Marienburg job, but if for once he told the truth, then the story should have read like this in the Nazi newspapers. The bombers of the U.S. 8th Air Force invaded Marienburg today, northeast of Berlin. Two flying fortresses were shot down. Another German factory is missing.